Who doesn't know the name of the first person to set foot on the moon? But do you know who the last person on the moon was? Eugene Cernan. He was one of the three astronauts sent to the moon in 1972 during the Apollo 17 mission. He is the last of the 12 people who walked on the moon during six manned lunar landing missions. The last man on the moon. Just before leaving, he parked his rover 190 meters away from the capsule, which was about to be launched from the moon to the orbital spacecraft. While preparing the antenna and camera for the final television broadcast from the surface, he said, "History will record that the American challenge of today has forged man's destiny of tomorrow. And as we leave the moon and Taurus Littrow, we leave as we came and, God willing, as we shall return." The last two people left the moon, met their colleague who was waiting for them on the spacecraft in orbit, and then returned to Earth. 50 years have passed since then. Now, humanity is once again ready to set foot on the moon. This time, however, the goal is to establish permanent bases there. Just like the Apollo program, the Artemis program aims to make a manned lunar landing. In Greek mythology, Artemis is the sister of Apollo. In fact, NASA plans to send the first woman astronaut to the moon during this space mission. Initially, they had set the target for 2024, but due to some setbacks in the program, the new goal is 2026. The Artemis III mission will take place in 2026 if everything goes according to plan. Subscribe now to not miss videos that will cover the developments and results of the manned Artemis missions. Both the first woman and the first non-white person are expected to be sent to the moon. For this, two precursor missions are needed. Artemis I and Artemis II were specifically designed for this purpose. Launched in 2022, Artemis I was an uncrewed mission, but it was a full-scale rehearsal as if humans were aboard. During their missions, Artemis crews will live aboard the Orion capsule, designed to keep a four-person crew alive and healthy for up to 21 days in space. Each Orion capsule will fly with a European service module, provided by the European Space Agency, which will carry solar panels, life support systems, fuel tanks, and the main engine needed to enter the moon's orbit. As you can see, the most significant difference between Artemis and the Apollo missions is that Artemis involves international cooperation. NASA is working not only with U.S. manufacturers, but also with space agencies from other countries. The collaboration skills gained from working on the International Space Station set this mission apart from the first lunar missions. For Orion to begin its journey to the moon, it will need a very powerful rocket. For this, the Space Launch System, SLS, has been developed. This rocket is a three-stage system powered by a mixture of liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen. The first stage will actually use four RS-25 rocket engines, which were originally developed for the Space Shuttle program. Each SLS rocket will also have two large solid-fuel booster rockets attached to the core stage. Together, all of these will generate 8.8 million pounds of thrust during launch, which is 15% more powerful than the Saturn V rocket from the Apollo program. Therefore, when this rocket was launched in 2022, it earned the title of the most powerful rocket ever launched from Earth, standing about 100 meters tall, about the height of a 32-story building. As you may know, shortly afterward, Starship broke this record. So, what will happen during the Artemis III mission after the astronauts land there? They will dock with SpaceX's Starship spacecraft, which will be waiting for them. They will transfer to Starship, which will be responsible for the moon landings and launches. So, aside from the program being international, another key difference from the Apollo missions is that it will be partially civilian. NASA is working not only with space agencies from other nations, but also with commercial companies for this project. Now, I'm sure you, like me, might be wondering, if SpaceX's Starship is going to land and take off the astronauts from the moon, why are they traveling there in a different vehicle from the start? Can't Starship just take them directly from Earth to the moon? Wouldn't that be more logical? Of course it would be. But things are not that simple. It's a bit more complicated. Not just from an engineering standpoint, but also from a political one. It's a complex issue. Perhaps I will explain these aspects in another video. Now, there have been spacecraft sent much farther than this in the last 10 years, but for the first time, a spacecraft designed to carry humans will travel this far from Earth. For the return journey, Orion will make another close flyby to gain more gravity assist from the Moon. At exactly the right moment, its engines will fire, and it will position itself on its new trajectory back to Earth. The mission will end when Orion safely returns to Earth. This might be the most critical part of the mission. The spacecraft will approach the Earth's atmosphere at a speed of 40,000 kilometers per hour. This is an incredibly fast speed, especially when you consider that even the International Space Station orbits at 27,000 kilometers per hour. The Earth's atmosphere will generate temperatures of 2,800 degrees on the capsule's heat shield. Finally, Orion will land with parachutes near a recovery ship off the coast of San Diego. That's the plan. However, as always, last-minute developments could affect these dates and timelines. The second Artemis mission, which will be crewed but only orbiting the Moon, is planned for September 2025. While reviewing these plans, I noticed both the differences and the similarities to the Apollo missions. In 2026, the first woman astronaut will take her first steps on the Moon at the lunar South Pole. She will stay on the Moon's surface for 6.5 days with her fellow astronaut. Let me explain why 6.5 days. Unlike the Apollo missions, which landed near the Moon's equator, Artemis III will land near the Moon's South Pole. Recently, NASA revealed 13 potential landing sites, each roughly a 15-kilometer square, with each square containing at least 10 possible landing areas. NASA is considering these locations because they contain previously unexplored geological features. Each area has a flat terrain for a safe landing, and, more importantly, is positioned in such a way that it will receive uninterrupted sunlight for 6.5 days, allowing the astronauts to carry out their tasks during the sunny days. There are also areas near the target landing sites that are in permanent shadow. These areas contain regolith, lunar rock and dust, that may hold chemical signatures of water. This has been previously discovered and identified. If they can extract water ice from the lunar regolith, they could potentially establish a base similar to research stations in Antarctica. The amount of water in the dust and how easily it can be extracted is still unknown. To learn whether the water in that region is usable, NASA had planned to send a robotic rover named Viper to explore the lunar South Pole for more data by 2026. However, due to cost increases and delays in the readiness of the exploration vehicle and Griffin landing craft, the project was canceled in July 2024. One of the main tasks for the Artemis III astronauts in 2026 will be to continue the investigation that this rover never got to begin. For nearly a quarter century, people have been working continuously in space in Earth's low orbit. In fact, at times, there were 13 people in space at the same time. Now, the Moon is the next target. The first goal is to establish permanent bases there. I say bases because this goal is not just for the United States, but also for China. But these are very expensive goals. According to NASA's Office of Inspector General, the costs for Artemis-related programs are estimated to reach nearly $93 billion by 2026. And each of the first three Artemis launches, mentioned in this video, will cost around $4.1 billion. For comparison, SpaceX's weekly launches cost about $50 million, so each lunar mission will cost 80 times more. Nearly half of NASA's annual budget is allocated to human spaceflight missions like these. It's also worth noting that NASA's total budget currently represents about 0.4% of the federal discretionary spending. These are massive budgets, and naturally, they are often a topic of debate within the U.S. public, with many people opposing them. However, when compared to the Apollo program, the costs have been reduced by 5 to 6 times. So why are we sending humans back to the Moon after 50 years? One important thing that the samples brought back from the Apollo missions revealed is that the moon's surface, with its rocks and impact craters, acts like a library that tells the 4.5 billion year history of the solar system. This is the scientific reason behind the renewed lunar goals. Among the renewed objectives for the moon is the idea of positioning it as a training ground for missions to other parts of the solar system. The moon and Mars are very different in many ways, but the lessons learned on the moon, such as building shelters, establishing bases, conducting deep space travels, and extracting water from ice deposits, will be crucial for the human exploration of Mars. This is another reason: training and gaining experience. However, I believe the real driving force behind sending humans back to the moon after 50 years is a new and different commercial race. Despite being excluded from the ISS, China, one of the last countries to join the space race, has quickly developed its own space station and successfully landed on the moon. Now, China plans to establish a permanent base on the moon as well. Now, expectations are high for Artemis, the sister program to Apollo. These two human space programs, named after the Greek goddess, will inspire two separate generations. We will witness the continuation of historical developments in this century in cyclical patterns.